I'm Wade Price, and there will be an official errata document regarding me in 2 weeks' time. Today, I'm sitting down with senior games developer Robin Cruddace, who is the custodian for the Warhammer 40,000 game system in the Citadel Books and Box Games studio. Hi, Robin.
Hi, how's it going?
It's very good, thank you. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Welcome to VoxCast.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
So, have you seen any of the VoxCasts we've put out so far?
I have. They've been ace, and I'm really nervous because that's a hard act to follow.
Well, not at all. You are the first games developer that we've had onto VoxCast. We've done a few Stormcast episodes with Jervis and Sam, but you are the senior Warhammer 40,000 games developer. Is that your title?
That is, yeah. Now, I'm also the lead rules writer for Warhammer 40,000 for this edition, which is great. I get to look at everything that's done from a rules point of view, for 40,000. It's a dream come true.
So how did you get into doing this then? What's your background?
My background? Well, I think ever since I went to university, that was the first opportunity to work for Games Workshop. I've been into the hobby probably for 10 years before that. And actually, it was very similar to Darren's story. HeroQuest and then kind of Space Crusade, those kind of board games were some of the first avenues I had to kind of explore. And it was all around my cousin's house. It's all his fault, really. You know, off we go. Mums and dads are all having coffee somewhere. And the cousins all just kind of like get together. And I was on the younger side, and they were all older. And they had like white dwarves, and they had all these kind of like books and things. And, oh, what's this? It's great. And one of them's kind of putting together his very first Space Marine. And as the younger cousin at the time, it was come on, you can join in. But I was hooked, and it was great. You get your first Space Marine, and they're talking about dwarves and elves and things like that. And you're just like, oh, what's going on? This is great. So I got hooked from an early age on board games, and slowly just kind of started building up from there. I think probably Epic was one of my first kind of like actual purchases of a boxed game.
Fair play.
And so I actually built up this kind of vast army, but even then, through things like Renegades and that, you get exposed to kind of the artwork and the lore and things like that, and you're reading all about kind of Eldar and Chaos, and it's just, you need your next fix then. You just kind of, where do you go from there?
And where did you go?
Where did I go? Well, I then just started dabbling. I think from Space Crusade, I went on to Space Hulk. From Space Hulk, I was like, whoa, I want to get some of these Dark Angel Deathwing Terminators. So I kind of painted up those and started playing some Space Hulk with that. That eventually led to a Dark Angels army. And then kind of like 10 years later on, I've got, you know, just a bit here, a bit there, kind of painting along, you know, playing some Necromunda and things along the way. Then a store opened up not too far away from where I lived. And that was a huge event because it was hard to find a Games Workshop store kind of 20 years or so ago. But one opened up in the pool store, and I kind of went in there, and they were just like, "Have you got an army?" I was like, "Well, I've got these Dark Angels," and said, "Why don't you bring them along then?" Which I did, and I played my first game of Warhammer 40,000, and that was it. And I just knew from that point on, it's like, "Oh, how cool would it be to kind of like write this sort of game?" And you know, however many years later on, I actually did, so it's kind of cool.
So which edition of Warhammer 40,000 was that you started playing?
Oh, goodness, it must have been around 3rd, 4th edition.
Okay.
So quite some time ago now. And then I kind of went off to university and joined as a key timer. Mm-hmm. So I worked in retail, mostly during the holidays. So I was kind of a holiday hitman. You know, study, read hard when you're at university, come back, and then effectively tour all the way around the South Coast, doing, you know, 4 hours here, 6 hours there. Yeah. But just getting to meet loads of cool guys who worked in the stores and all the kind of cool customers, have a look at what they're painting, what they're playing with, and actually just opened up my eyes completely that we've got all different kinds of customers, and everybody is different what they like. Some people will love painting individual models to kind of put in cabinets. Some people are all about kind of collecting as many different armies as they can, and everything in between. And just talking to the people, everyone's just got this passion. It's a really good experience working for retail because everybody's just geeking out about different parts about the hobby, and you just have really cool chats. And you know, that's basically what you were paid to do, is just talk to customers. And at the end of it, it's like, "Oh, that's a great idea," and off they go. And you start a new army, and in your head you're going, "Oh, that's a cool idea. I could do something similar to that." And you just have these really cool conversations about the hobby.
And did you go from working in the store to the studio, or was there a period of time in between?
So I had a gap. So at the end of my studies, I decided I'm going to stay in school a little bit longer. And so I studied to do a PhD, at which point I kind of left Games Workshop for a few years. But I did my research, and after three, four years of that, I was looking for jobs left, right, and centre, as many graduates are. And amongst those was this job for games developer, which again was that job that, you know, from 20 years, oh, how cool would that be to actually do that? Mm-hmm. Who are these lucky souls who get to do that? And I always remember the kind of the interview process for it was really long. It was kind of like 6 months from start to finish. Because they were kind of like, there were written tests, there were kind of like two rounds of interviews, an assessment day, some more written tests, back and forth. And I was looking at kind of like science jobs and kind of research jobs, analyst jobs, all sorts of things.
Stock mad scientist stuff.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. So I did all my studies were in physics. So I was a scientician for a while. But it was really good fun. Just kind of like, can you write some rules for this? Can you write some background for that? And so you're just kind of doing it for fun, really. And then you kind of progress from one stage of the interview to the next, and you got to come up to head office and have a look around, and that was kind of cool. And I think at that point I was like, that's it. I've been to the kind of like the absolute, you know, place where Games Workshop was born. I've seen Warhammer World. I've seen some pre-release stuff. I've talked to some of the people. I can die happy now if this interview stage goes no further. But it did, and it kept going to the next stage. And eventually, I just got this phone call out of the blue, and it was, you know, do you want to come and write games and background for us? And I was like, do I? So I didn't look back, and that was 12 years or so ago now.
Wow. I remember when you started. That makes me feel very old.
We are old.
We are old now.
It still feels like I'm the new boy in certain things. Because I think when I joined in, there were kind of like these hobby giants. You kind of had Gav, you had Alessio, you had all these other people, and so I very much felt like the new boy. But I really learned so much from them, and I think it's a very thing. A great thing about Games Workshop is the culture. Mm-hmm. Everybody's really willing to kind of, you know, give you some feedback and help you learn, and they really want to know what you think. That was the thing that surprised me the most, having come from a kind of like very sciencey background, moving into kind of the design studio. I was always a little bit apprehensive. I think there are certain stereotypes you have, particularly at university. You've kind of got like the science students and the art students, mm-hmm. and you're like, oh no, is everyone going to be really kind of like precious about their work? And day one, I think it was Alex Boyd came up and was just like, you know, this bit of artwork you've done, and he's just like, what do you think about this? And you're just going, oh, it was great. What about this thing? And she's like, you're right. And he's off away. So actually, everybody has just got one thing in common. They just want to make the coolest, best thing they can do. Mm. And the number one way you get that is just by talking to people, getting the feedback, listening to it, not being offended by it, and actually using that to make the product the best it possibly can be. Mm-hmm. And that was the kind of like the big kind of like veil lifted from my eyes. I was like, this isn't a studio full of kind of like artists, and oh no, it's just people wanting to do the best thing, who are really passionate about what they do. And so, yeah, I was like, oh, I've got to stay as part of this. And I was convinced that any moment now, they were going to knock the doors in and go, look, there he is, get him. He doesn't belong here.
He's a scientist.
But I seem to have avoided that gang with pitchforks for so far, so yeah. Long may it continue.
Absolutely. Drink to that. I guess when talking about how there was a six-month recruitment process, it's apparent that games developer role historically was, and still is, really important. We don't see an awful lot of turnover. We don't see a lot of new faces coming and going in the role of games developer. Once the studio decides this is somebody that we would like to write books and box games for us for a little while, I guess there has to be that kind of period of investigation or making sure that's the right person, because that means that when you do join the studio, that Alex Boyd can feel, well, I can ask this person what they think, because the studio spent 6 months deciding this is the right person for this role. So you definitely bring stuff on the first day.
Yeah, it's an odd job. It's not as if there's like an apprenticeship or a training or a degree course in it.
It's a baptism of fire.
It is a little bit, you know. And I remember first few weeks, and you get like a week's kind of like grace, and you know, it's like maybe write a white dwarf article or something like that. But then, you know, within month one, it's like, cool, right, time for your first codex. Mm-hmm. And you're a little bit like, sorry, what? Everything else has got a kind of a how do you train for this job? Mm-hmm. I think Sam touched upon it a little bit in Stormcast podcast, where you just practice. I think that's what the interview process back in the day was all about. It was kind of giving you an opportunity to write some rules, to write some game mechanics and get them tested, but also to write some background, which is something which games developers used to do everything. Since then, we've kind of specialized a little bit and focused down. But it had so many different facets to it. I think the games developer role that was used to kind of have three different hats to it. kind of had your background kind of hat, and kind of like, how do you write the cool evocative kind of fiction that you're going to read, the bestiary entries, the timelines, that kind of thing. And I learned an awful lot, as I mentioned, from people like Gav, from people like Phil Kelly, who've been doing this for, you know, longer than I have. Then there's the kind of the rules side of things. How do you write kind of cool rules that are going to marry up with that background? How are you going to write things that are going to give you interesting ways to kind of build armies and kind of use them on the tabletop? And I learned an awful lot from some of the other guys there. And then the kind of the third part of being a games developer was kind of like a project lead kind of hat. Because all the different kind of aspects that go into a codex, at some point you used to kind of like touch upon or kind of like skim by. So you had to kind of know a little bit of what's going on here, what's going on there, what's going on with the painting, what's going on with the artwork. Because at the end of the day, you were trying to make a book, and everything that's going into that book wants to kind of like be coherent and kind of like say the same story, really, just through kind of different mediums, I suppose. So you would kind of like go and have talks and conversations, set up meetings, and make sure everybody was on the same page. And it was really interesting, because I didn't think that would be what the job was at all. And actually, that soon became one of the most important parts of it, is setting up those meetings to begin with, and kind of like discussing these things, getting feedback, making sure that everybody at every stage had a chance to kind of contribute. And, you know, it does make a difference where a good idea comes from. You know, sometimes an artist particularly loves a particular army, and he'll be able to kind of contribute towards that. And I think one of the best examples was working on one version of Codex Space Marines.
Yep.
And it was an opportunity then to kind of really kind of like, right, no holds bar, what's the coolest Space Marine Codex that we can do? And we just got all the Space Marine enthusiasts, and, you know, from art, from design, from the background, all in one room. I remember kind of like coming in with bags full of, you know, cakes and donuts, and it's like, right, what could we do? And eventually we kind of like had like page plan out, like, what could the Imperial Fist section be, what could the Raven Guard section be, right, how can we replicate that in rules, how can we do that with art, how can we do that with design? And we had this kind of like magnificent Space Marine Codex, but actually that was all the kind of the project design, the project lead part of it. And that came all before we actually started putting pen to paper in terms of words or rules or anything like that.
So how does it feel, the shoe being on the other foot now, as the senior games developer in the team? You must be setting work for new people, because we've seen there's been a few games developers hired by the studio quite recently.
We have, yeah. So I'm in a team of four games developers now. So there's myself, there's James, Duncan and Elliot, and I'm sure you'll get to speak to them later. And between us, we've got to get every single rule for 140,000 written, play tested, and out the door for people to enjoy. So I was very lucky to be able to, you know, lead up the 8th edition. But part of that was thinking, what do we want the rules to be throughout the entire cycle of 8th edition's lifetime? It wasn't just going to make a set of rules and then what's next. It's what do we think codexes could look like? What expansions do we want to do? Even at the very beginning, we had an idea of kind of like chapter approved and how that could kind of plug in. How do we want to get this thing playtested out in the community? So you almost kind of start from the opposite end. So we've already got like a plan of kind of what these things might be, and thinking, well, what are the kind of rules that we want in a codex? It wasn't just a case of going, it's just going to be the units, it's going to be the units. And we had this idea for things called stratagems. We want the psychic powers and warlord traits and all the rest of it. Once you know what that framework is, you can make sure that your core rules are kind of set up to support that. And what I am now able to do, having got like a few of those under my belt, is say to the guys, okay, what you're working on, Codex X or Codex Y, this is kind of like the standard, these are the sort of things that we want to be able to get out of it within that framework.
Have you found these new guys have been bringing fresh ideas, things that you hadn't considered at all?
Very much so, yeah. they've all got different skills, different things that they kind of bring to the table. Duncan has got a huge amount of experience with all sorts of war games. James plays every board game and game under the sun, so he can bring all that kind of knowledge to him. Mm-hmm. And Elliot's worked in our events team for many years, so he's actually seen a lot of these things on the tabletop. But having those different kind of heads just means that the feedback that you get kind of covers as many bases as it can. It would be a shame if we all thought in the same way, then when we kind of all sit together and go, oh, okay, what is the play style for this going to be, or what kind of stratagems could we do for that? It would all be very very similar. We want to have different ideas and challenge people. There's something really refreshing about those guys asking those questions, because it forces you to kind of think back and go, no, the reason why we do that is because, why is the reason why
there was a good reason,
but actually it kind of forces you back to kind of like those kind of core principles and go, well, there was a reason why we do this. Is that still applicable, or is that a thing that we kind of said, no, you can never write this kind of rule because it breaks a thing in 5th edition? We're not in 5th edition anymore. Does that still apply or not? So I've learned loads from them, because they forced me to kind of go back to the initial kind of like document that we had when we were writing 8th edition and going, these are the goals and these are the objectives we're trying to set out to achieve, and just sort of say, are the rules that we're writing still trying to do the same thing? Are they still as cool as they could be? Are they still as fun as they can be? And actually some of the times you're like, oh no, we've kind of like not explored this avenue, but we could, couldn't we? Ooh, what does that mean? What does that open up?
And you mentioned the playtesters as well, and it feels like Games Workshop's brought the playtesters more on board, or made them more front and centre, acknowledging them in the credit sections of the books. And there's two 40K playtesting groups.
We've got two dedicated teams, yeah.
Could you tell us a bit about those and how they got set up?
Yeah, so I think even from the very beginning, we knew we wanted to do everything again. We wanted to do all the index books again. We wanted to do all the codexes in just over a year. That was a huge amount to kind of get through. And we also knew of people around the world who were experts at this. They run tournaments, they run events. They know how to take the game to the very edge of its limits, mm-hmm. and kind of break it. And that's the point where we sometimes struggle. I think as a games developer, you are first and foremost trying to create a fun game that kind of reflects the background, but we sometimes focus on the narrative side of things. Do the rules that we write reflect the background, the flavor of the army? Does it have some interesting play styles? But actually, when it comes to kind of taking it to the very extreme, we're not the experts in that, but mm-hmm. we know the people who were. So we got in contact with these summer guys and just went, would you be interested in helping us out? And they were all up for it. And so we got a group from America, from London, all sorts of places, and we brought them into the studio and went, this is what we think 8th edition could be. And they kind of pored over it, and they had a look through some data sheets and played some games, and they gave us some really like useful feedback, and we're like, wow, this is really good. They're kind of opening our eyes up to kind of little rules, niches or hooks or things that we just didn't think about beforehand. And we're like, well, would you be willing to kind of like carry on helping us with that? And they were like, yeah, that sounds cool. And so the Mournival, I guess, were kind of born. And every single codex, White Dwarf article, anything like that, they have a little look at. They give us some feedback on that, and we really take them on board. And we really couldn't do this without them. They look at all the points values, and they really kind of help us polish and hone our rules to hopefully the high degree and high quality they are now. A little while into 8th edition's lifetime, we decided that we wanted to kind of capture the narrative side of things as well, because we thought we were doing quite a good job there, but let's make sure. Mm-hmm. And so we effectively recruited another set of playtesters who were ended up called the Infinity Circuit, and their role is really to kind of like help ensure that we are capturing the essence of the different armies, the background, the flavor, and making sure that both those things kind of like tie up with the rules. So together they kind of like, our playtesting teams help to keep us honest.
Yep.
Both from a kind of like a match play side of things, but also from a narrative play side of things. Because we just want to make sure that people like our books. It's always a nervous time whenever we send anything out for an external playtest, because we do an awful lot of work kind of leading up to that, and then it's kind of let out, not into the wild, but certainly people outside of the studio who...
Into a controlled environment.
Yeah, but they can look at stuff and they can say, look, this isn't working, or this just felt... like it could do more, but you also get sometimes the this is great, don't change that, that's super fun, and those things aren't necessarily what you thought they'd be sometimes, but it's nonetheless it's very interesting, and again it's one of the kind of the core things of working in the studio is get feedback, mm-hmm. take that feedback on board, because what you're trying to get out of it is the best possible thing. They're all real hobbyists, our playtesters. We're hobbyists too. We play games as well. And you just want to make sure everyone's enjoying what you're doing.
Do you ever find, because you've got people around the world contributing this feedback, do you ever get contradicting or contrasting feedback, contradictory feedback from the different groups that you have to rationalise, or is it usually all in the same sort of direction?
9 times out of 10, it's usually in the same direction, which is reassuring.
Yeah.
But yeah, sometimes you do get kind of contradictory feedback, but that's the nature of hobbyists. Every hobbyist's journey is different, and every hobbyist is after something different. What one person really likes, another person isn't too fond of. And then you just have to kind of pull that with your own experiences, but also what the goals of the project itself might be.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had some great bits of feedback. You're like, that's a great idea. It's just not quite right for this particular project or for this particular time, because working in the studio, we know the future a little bit. We know that there might be some other projects, or there might be a chapter approved article that might cover that thing there, or there might be something else further down the line. So sometimes we just want to keep our powder dry.
So should we talk about 40k 8th edition?
Please.
That was quite a big deal, wasn't it? That was
awesome.
That was huge. Do you remember what the kind of objectives for that project were when that started?
Because
it's about 3 years ago that it must have started, that work really began, wasn't it?
It was more like 4 years or so ago. We start really far ahead, just thinking what... The kind of tagline was very simple. Make the best... science fantasy miniatures game in the world.
Mm-hmm.
No pressure.
Done it before, right?
Well, yeah. But we wanted to kind of, at this point, the kind of everything was off the table. We were kind of, we didn't have to kind of maintain the codexes or anything like that. It's just like a fresh slate, start again. It's a games developer's dream, but it's also a huge kind of responsibility, starting from a game from a blank piece of paper. But again, it wasn't quite blank, because again, you're right, we had a game before it, we had Age of Sigmar, and we knew what we wanted to try and do.
Mm-hmm.
And the big kind of like the word was accessibility.
Yeah.
That was one of the real big things that we'd got from feedback, was that we had a huge tome, kind of 300 or so pages. And some people felt it was quite intimidating to kind of get in and just sort of play games of with their toy soldiers. They just wanted to be able to get and play some 140,000, roll some dice as quickly as they could.
Mm-hmm.
So accessibility was a really big thing for us. And part of that meant, well, actually, how can we take complexity out? And I guess we wanted to keep the depth of kind of tactics and strategy that you could use. The way we did that was kind of flipping 40k on its head a little bit. The way we'd presented it in the past was this kind of vast tome of rules. It felt like you had to learn all of them, but actually by the time you got to the tabletop, you only needed a kind of a fraction of those things. There was a great big list of universal special rules, which you maybe needed two or three of. So why don't we present it that way? And actually, instead of kind of going sort of like, you know, top down, it was kind of bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
And we then kind of like, what's the minimum size that we would need to describe the core rules? And the core rules haven't changed an awful lot ever since we started doing it. All the back to road trader, they kind of describe how you move your miniatures, how they shoot, how they fight, how you kind of test bravery, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we had data sheets, which was inspired by Age of Sigmar and its war scrolls, but also previous editions of Warhammer 40,000. But we decided to make those just work a little bit harder for us. So instead of having universal special rules in the core book, if there's a rule you needed, pop it on your data sheet.
Yeah.
The rules that you need are the rules that you needed at the point where you needed them. You didn't need to kind of like learn all this stuff up and then it was like a test when you're on the battlefield. How much you can remember. the core rules were all designed about getting you to the tabletop as quickly as you could. So I think there was a challenge set by Jervis, you know, got it done in 4 pages. But we actually started Warhammer 40,000 from 7th edition, and we kind of sat down with a highlighter, and it was it became a challenge of going, well, okay, what if we get rid of the universal special rules, right, that's that many pages cut, and we had a look at things like templates and go, okay, well, is there a different way of writing templates? Because if we do, we cut 12 pages out, and then if we treat all units the same, then actually we halved everything else, because it was only when we kind of started looking back and being really critical about what we had done. The rules for, say, how things like vehicles might work were actually longer than the actual core rules for 40K itself. And all these things kind of like had built up incrementally over time, but we had the chance to kind of like level the playing field and start again. But we didn't want to lose any of the coolness that was 40K. We actually went down a completely different route to begin with. And it was only after we kind of, and that's part and parcel of being a games developer, as you start down one avenue and then you kind of stop and you look back and you get some feedback and go, maybe that isn't the right way, and then you kind of have to backtrack a little bit and you kind of pursue a different path until you get to where we got to, which was 8th edition.
And what of the features of 8th edition do you most like, or are you most proud of, that was implemented this time around?
There are two parts of it. One's very subtle, one's very, very obvious. Mm-hmm. Very obvious thing are command points and stratagems. Yep. I think that's the rule that's kind of helped to define this edition, to kind of mark it out above its peers. Mm-hmm. It's opened up loads of kind of like talking points, tactics, combinations, and it's been really rewarding. So the whole point, or the whole method of kind of building up command points and spending them has been great. Mm-hmm. But the thing that's kind of unlocked it, and the subtle bit, are kind of the choose your own keywords mechanic.
Yeah.
So we knew we wanted to have keywords because we'd seen it in Age of Sigmar, and we'd consider the kind of the power, how it's helped to kind of like really kind of like clarify what rules should affect what things. Mm-hmm. And that's the other kind of like big thing we're always looking at doing. We want to kind of make our rules as clear as it can be. I think Sam's mentioned before that rules as intended equals rules as written. Yep. That's kind of like a really big thing. Yep. Keywords are the thing that really help us do that. But the choose your own keywords thing felt really powerful, because it suddenly meant that it's not just a Space Marines army. And if you talk to everybody, and it's one of the coolest thing, whether or not, you know, it's from retail when you're talking to people in stores or you're attending events, people don't usually collect Space Marine armies. They'll go, I collect Blood Angels, I collect Ultramarines, I collect Howling Griffins. Mm-hmm. And people really like to be able to personalize their army, but it's always just been like a background talking point. The choose your own keywords really allows you to kind of put your stamp on your army. You know, I really do collect Howling Griffins because look, it's on the data sheet. Mm-hmm. You know, it's different to your Iron Hawks or your Salamanders or your Raven Guard. It's my army. But it also then meant that the right people could shout at the right people on the battlefield and inspire people. It's always a little bit unsatisfying when Dark Angel captains are kind of barking orders at Space Wolves. I think normally they'll just kind of look at each other and, oh, you what?
Yeah. Trash talking each other, maybe. But
that's
not
it. They'd be brawling, surely. Yeah. But the kind of like the next thing that kind of opens up is all the different rules we can put into codexes. We didn't do it for indexes. It's something that we wanted to keep for our codexes. So the difference between Ultramarines, Salamanders, Raven Guard, even going back to kind of like the 6th, 7th edition Space Marine Codex, when we kind of like started exploring, well, how can we do these different chapters? If you can choose what your keywords are going to be, then actually they can have rules meanings as well. You can have relics that are specific to different chapters or orc clans or whatever it might be for every single codex that's out there. And that's the kind of like been the joy. That was the kind of the plan all the way from the beginning, is going, what are the kind of rules that we want to put in those codexes? How can we find ways of putting them in there? So just ever such a simple little thing, choose your own keyword, and then suddenly you've opened the door for going, oh, actually, I could be Bladed Cog or Rusted Claw or Cult of the Four-Armed Emperor, and that has a proper rules meaning. That gives you a slightly different play style. It opens up different tactics or things for you to explore, as well as kind of opening up doors for kind of like new color schemes or paint schemes or narrative hooks or whatever it is. So that's been hugely rewarding. Mm-hmm. And the stratagems kind of like come after that, because they're just part of that.
Yeah. a way of expressing the differences between those armies.
Exactly.
Yeah. That chapter tactics for all, that kind of ambition. I was very conscious that we've had chapter tactics as a feature of Space Marine rules for about 15 years, I think now, like the early 2000s, and it has felt like it's been missing for the other armies, that you could paint orcs in different colours, and we know the backgrounds of the different clans, and to be able to get the appropriate reward is very satisfying. And Space Marine players have had that understanding that the book says Space Marines, but you are collecting a particular chapter, probably a particular company within that chapter. It's nice to be able to have that degree of focus for all of the other armies as well, because I guess, you know, from my experience in the studio, it then compels us to think about the differences between those different sub-factions. And I know the games developers have cool little meetings where you look at the existing background and how to best deploy the intellectual property as the equivalent of a chapter tactic or a relic or a warlord trait. Yep. Those meetings are always quite fun because you really get to get under the skin.
They're hugely fun. With my position, I'm in a fortunate position of kind of like being able to stand at the front of the whiteboard with a pen and actually kind of run them. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we all literally get in a room together, and it'll be whatever it is, Space Marines or Orcs, and we literally go around the thing and right at the very top of the board, all the different clan names and everything we know about that clan. You know, evil sons like to go faster, bad moons like to show off, goths just like to punch people, kick people, and headbutt people, and just stomp them. Every single aspect of the background. We get background writer involved, sometimes an artist, anybody who can contribute and loves that thing. We get all the background down, all the little hooks and niches and things like that. And it, you know, populate this huge kind of like matrix, I suppose, of kind of attributes, personality quirks, and then we have the fun job going, all right, how do we translate that into rules, into mechanics that are going to be different? We tend to do it for an entire codex at a time, because I guess you don't want the ingredients to kind of be the same. If you end up kind of defining White Scars as being fast, aggressive, and skilled, you don't accidentally want to have another chapter which is kind of skilled, aggressive. You see what I mean? Yeah. So it's good to kind of like put those things up on the board so you can really pick out the things that make the different chapter, Forge World, jump out and make them unique. Mm-hmm. So each army's kind of got an army special rule and kind of like a different play style. And then the kind of like the sub-faction, I guess, adds a different kind of like depth to that. So actually, if you want to take Genestealer Cults, if you want to kind of like go down more of that kind of ambushing kind of route, then Cult of the Four-Armed Emperor is for you. If you want to kind of go down that more elite monster heavy army, then Twisted Helix is probably for you. And these things can kind of help to open up new either kind of like army building kind of like hooks or play styles or anything like that. But yeah, you tend to have, I think it's like kind of four bites of the cherry usually. You can use warlord traits, chapter tactics, or whatever the equivalent might be, relics, and stratagems. And so you've got four different kind of rules levers to try and encapsulate some of that thing. So I think warlord traits are always good for kind of like personality traits, whether you're very brave, you're very angry. Stratagems are quite good for anything that might affect a particular unit. I think White Scars, I've got one that affects bikes, so if you happen to not have any bikes in your White Scars army, I'm not sure why you would ever be in that situation, but if you don't, then you can always spend your command points on something different. And then you can choose things like relics and chapter tactics that kind of affect everything. That's what you really want, is a chapter tactic that's going to make your army do something regardless of what you've got. If you've just chosen, you're like, I'm going to have that army, I'm going to paint it that color because it looks cool, you've still got a chapter tactic that'll do something. And it's very—it's one of the biggest things we do with playtesting, is try and make sure these things are all internally balanced. What I mean by that is that there isn't any choice of chapter, Forge World, or whatever it is that is an auto-choose, and there isn't one that is kind of like a never-choose. You always want to go, oh, in this situation I might have this, in that situation I might have, oh, okay, it's all kind of a zero net sum at the end of the day.
Okay. And working on those sub-factions, establishing them and fleshing them out, I imagine that would also stand to the studio if that becomes a dedicated range of miniatures in the future, because I think when we've done Chaos Space Marines in the past, all the Traitor Legions were encompassed in the one Chaos Space Marines book, but we did work in 7th edition on the Traitor Legion supplement and the Wrath of Magnus with a Thousand Suns, mm-hmm. and there were Warlord traits and things created for them, psychic powers, and that meant when 8th edition rolled around and it was accompanied by a load of wonderful Death Guard miniatures, we were perfectly placed to create a Death Guard Codex, and working on those different sub-factions, I'm not sure there's any chance of Cult of the Rusted Claw specific miniatures coming out in the near future, but the Books and Box Game Studio would be ready were that ever to happen.
It. Yeah, absolutely.
And Space Marine chapters, I guess, there'd be a... Yeah.
So Space Marines and Chaos Space Marines are two great examples. When you're planning out the entire range, a whole lifetime, you have that in the back of your brain. Mm. So you're not just looking at Codex Space Marines, you're going to go, hey, Codex Space Marines, well, actually, what's the impact for that going to be for Space Wolves, for Dark Angels, for Blood Angels? So you tend to do... Those things tend to go on your whiteboard when you're doing your planning meeting at the very beginning anyway, because you want to be able to leave room mm. so that Blood Angels can still feel like Blood Angels, Dark Angels can still feel like Dark Angels. So you plan it all at the beginning, and you kind of like earmark and kind of like ring fence, I suppose, the kind of the rule space that you want to explore for those things later on, even though you may not actually get to writing them for a few months down the line. You can do all the planning at the front and kind of like front load it so that you're not going to step on anyone's toes.
Yeah, and Books and Box Games tend to work about a year before the publication of something, and give or take, that's my recollection. And then the miniatures are worked on for longer than that, so the work on the miniatures starts earlier, so that if miniatures were planning to introduce something completely revelatory to the tabletop miniatures experience, you'd have plenty of warning. They wouldn't be telling you, next week you need to add a range of gaseous god beasts to the Warhammer 40,000 range.
It's never a kind of like surprise. Mm. We have good conversations with the miniatures guys well before we ever kind of like put pen to paper. Mm-hmm. And actually, you know, even when we do start a thing, we'll sometimes go back down to them and just kind of go, what's the idea behind this? You know, is there some sort of special bullet this thing's that firing in your brain or anything like that? They're a wealth and they're an inspiration. But yeah, we're not taken by surprise. As to how long things take, sometimes a year, sometimes more. It all depends what the project is. Mm-hmm. Something like for 40K itself, the actual core rulebook, obviously, you know, huge kind of lead time. An expansion, something like Urban Conquest, or Chapter Approved, maybe a little bit less than a year, mm-hmm. Sometimes a little bit more. It just depends exactly what the components are, what's going in the box, and sometimes things change. Sometimes we'll write a book, and for one reason or another, things will get released at a different time. I think, if memory serves, the Astra Militarum book was actually one of the first ones that was written after we'd actually finished, but it was actually released a lot later than originally planned. And it just happens, you know, sometimes you have a little bit of time, someone writes something, but then you want to hold fire because there's a new miniature that you want something to coincide with, or something wants to be brought forward for whatever reason.
I guess the playtesters have to be aware of that landscape as well to know what is going to be part of the gaming experience for everybody else once something new gets released into the world. And
yeah, and it's an ever changing landscape at the moment. I think we knew that the kind of the pace that we wanted to release stuff at was kind of unprecedented. Mm-hmm. One of my jobs is to kind of look after Warhammer 40,000 as a system, but it's a system that is forever changing. If you kind of imagine it as kind of like the surface of a pond, every time you release a new book or a new rule, you're basically throwing a rock into this pond, and it's causing kind of like ripples and waves and all the rest of it. So actually, it's never had a chance to kind of settle down. Just because we're adding so much cool new stuff into it. One of the things that we knew we could try and do to kind of help with that was Chapter Approved. We have a points review once a year, which is just a little way to kind of go, we know things have changed. Mm-hmm. We know that you know, Imperial Knights has come out, therefore your Laz Cannons have probably got a little bit more useful, a little bit more better take some of those along. Mm-hmm. Every time we do that, we've got a chance to readjust a little bit and bring things back in. That's why we wanted our external playtesters to help us with it, because they're on the front lines, they're running the events, they can really see these things being used and the things that aren't being used, and we can try and take steps to adjust them.
And knowing that at any stage, well, with plenty of notice, new things might be introduced by miniatures, I guess there has to be the realisation that things like Chapter Approved and the annual updates or regular updates on the website give Games Workshop the opportunity to kind of reset the balance as things stand. But it's going to need to be rebalanced in the future because we might add gods or more demon primarchs or return for anything that you couldn't really imagine existing right now might be part of the firmament of 40k in a couple of years' time, and everyone's going to have to be able to adapt to that.
Yeah, I think 140,000 was always designed to be versatile. I would describe it as a toolbox. Mm-hmm. So whether you are into open play, match play, or narrative play, there's something for you. And whilst we have those three different kind of categories, I think the truth is that nobody really sits firmly in one or another. You probably straddle two, if not all three, of those things. So why not be able to use 140,000 as a toolbox and use your favourite bits to it? So actually, if you really love narrative play, but actually you want to use points values, then go for it, or vice versa. I like match play, but actually power ratings give me a quicker way of getting my models on the tabletop, then that's fine too. It's essentially, we tried to design it so that it was your game, and every game was individual, and what each gaming club or gaming group was after was slightly different. But you can mix and match and change that around to make the game that's tailored for you.
What kind of games do you like to play when you're not playtesting, when you're using your Howling Griffins?
I think I'll describe myself as kind of a casual match play gamer. I sometimes use power rating, sometimes use points, but it's usually just to get some Space Marines on the table. I do love my Space Marines. Been playing with them now for 15 years plus, something like that.
How many points of Howling Griffins have you got now?
Probably over 6,000, something like that. I need to get more Primaris Marines in there. It's just going up and up now. Mm-hmm. But they started life out as a pure narrative army, because myself and four gaming friends were just, this was before I even worked for Games Workshop, there was an event advertised at Warhammer World, and it was a narrative campaign weekend. Okay. And we're like, that sounds great. So we chose one of the armies from the Rogue Trader, very famous spread, lots of different things. I went, whoa, Howling Griffins, you say? So my Howling Griffins kind of double quartered to match the scheme, and we all kind of bought an army, and then it's like five of us bought Howling Griffins army up each, and I've continued painting them since.
I've seen you adding whatever the new Space Marine releases for all the time I've known you in the studio.
Yeah, I've got some Hellblasters in there now, I've got some Intercessors on the way, so yeah, good fun.
Are you getting into the New Year, New Army initiative? Have you got anything new on the hobby table?
I really want to go back and examine some of my other armies, actually. So I've got a Necrons army. Yeah. I'd really like to kind of add some more.
Necrons.
Yeah, some Novok Necrons. I want to add some stuff to that. I'm really looking forward to these Plastic Sisters of Battle. I've got some Sacred Rose Sisters of Battle that are really looking forward to some of the cool stuff that's coming out.
And you've worked on some of the previous Sisters of Battle army lists, haven't you? You've worked on some of the ones from White Dwarf from the earlier editions.
I have, yeah.
And you worked on the Beta Codex in Chapter Approved.
Yes, very much so. I've been here for 12 years now, so I've worked on very many books. Mm-hmm. And that's part of the curse. Every time you finish a book, you're like, this is the coolest book we've done. I think that's always our goal, our benchmark, is to make sure that the next book is the best book we've ever done. And that just makes you want to go away and collect that army. And I think if you don't have a little bit like, oh yeah, I could do some Genestealer Cults or whatever it is, then you go back and work harder on that book.
So let's talk about this new greatest codex yet, which is Codex Genestealer Cults. That's the latest codex to be released. And that feels like it's got a lot more going on with it, or a few more things going on than maybe some of the codexes from the earliest run of 8th edition. It feels like there's some new ideas that have been brought in with that army special rule particularly. That's quite a departure from what the Genestealer Cults had before.
Yeah, it feels like it's the next kind of step. When we were planning which codexes we're doing in what order, Codex Genestealer Cults was down the way a little bit, and that part of that is because we knew that the miniatures guys were working on some fantastic new ideas, but it takes quite a long time. Darren was saying, from kind of like initial kind of concept of kind of new miniature to here's the new miniature ready to be sold. So we kind of pushed it back, and since that time we've learned a lot. We're a year older, a year wiser. We've tried certain rules, and we found these work really well, and these are kind of the tricky areas. And by the time we'd got there, we're like, whoa, everything's changed a little bit. We start by looking at the existing rules that were in the index and being really critical with ourselves. There were some aspects of that that just didn't seem to work as well. The Genestealer Cults are supposed to be this kind of great ambushing force. They've got their plan, thousands of years in the making, or whatever it may be, and suddenly out they come, and we've got a, I say deep strike, but it's not. It's you know, putting your models on the table, you know, 9 inches away or something like that. We knew from the very beginning that was going to be quite a powerful ability. So with the Genestealer Cults, with an entire army doing it, we had a dice roll in there. So some did it really well, some it was a little bit further away. But as we've gone on in 8th edition, that ability has become more commonplace, and we've seen that in lots more armies, lots more places, which left kind of Genestealer Cults in this kind of odd place whereby they were ambushing a little bit less reliably than everybody else. So we had this disconnect between the background and the rules, and we wanted to kind of set that right. So we went straight back to the drawing board, literally to the drawing board, and we came up with lots of different ideas for army rules. And you always start with the army rule, because whenever you do a codex, the first thing you want to do is to be able to write the data sheets. In order to write the data sheets, you need to know what the army special rule is, because it's going to feature on all of them. And They Should Know No Fear is kind of common to almost every single Space Marine, Death to False Emperor, to every Chaos Space Marine data sheet. So before you can finish a data sheet, you need to know what the kind of the combining army special rule is. And I use army rule to kind of distinguish it from detachment rules, which are kind of the relics and the stratagems and things you're going to get later on.
And that kicks in when you're a battle-forged army playing
absolutely. But regardless whether it's open play, narrative play, your data sheet describes what you want to do, and it's intrinsic to what that model is and how that army is going to end up playing. So you're going to end up with a play style, and hopefully that special rule is going to kind of help bring that out. So we came up with, well, I forget now, 7-8 different ideas, and we were kind of like running through, and some had some interesting, that's an interesting mechanic, that's quite interesting if you get the first turn, and there's another one over here. But nothing was kind of like absolutely kind of singing to you. And what we're looking at that stage isn't really kind of like a balance thing. It's a feel thing. Does it feel like a Genestealer Cult army? Does it evoke that idea of Genestealer Cults kind of boiling out of the sewers and you know, kind of like hidden, you know, throwing the tarpaulins off and, you know, blazing away, you know, oh no, they're coming out the walls kind of thing. And we're in a room not too dissimilar to this, you know, like board games and all the rest of it on the board. And I think we were halfway through a game, and I kind of spotted a copy of Space Hulk on the wall. I just had this kind of mad idea. It'll never work. It won't work. Well, could it? And I kind of walked over, and I came back with this kind of like fistful of blips, blip counters. And I went, I've got an idea, guys. And we kind of re-racked the game and kind of like did a section like it started off just like a hidden setup. And instantly it did something completely different to anything else that we've got in 40K. You know, once you get the first turn on the first turn, oh, okay, this has really got something to it. It instantly had that kind of like, this feels unique, this feels interesting, this feels like it's doing the job that the background wants it to do, whilst also giving you an interesting kind of like rules hook to kind of exploit. And straight away we're like, well, actually there could be some interesting stratagems that could interact with that, or faction abilities, or whatever it could be.
And it really feels like it is legitimately an army special rule, in that it describes how the army fights, as opposed to just being a unique rule that is shared by all of the units in that army, like And They Shall Know No Fear. It's definitely a rule unique to the Space Marines, but it doesn't necessarily describe how the army itself goes about fighting just the warriors in it. And that maybe feels
like
that.
I think the closest we've come to it is probably Power from Pain from Codex Drakari, which again, as the turn progresses, the rules bonuses you're getting from kind of all the pain and suffering that's kind of like on the battlefield kind of like elevates your warriors to ever new heights. So that also had kind of like the feeling of a rule, but it was there's something quite tactile about putting those markers down and trying to bluff. And the interesting thing that it did from our point of view is it kind of like on the psychology of the game, it kind of like gave the initiative to the Genestealer Cult player, kind of irrespective of who was going to get the first turn or not. There were situations where the opponent was going, oh, I'll let you go first then, which was kind of like huge, and actually just kind of like came out kind of like having played, you know, through our initial playtesting of it, you're like, ooh, this is doing some really interesting things with people not being able to commit their armies or kind of like do their alpha strikes, or you know the way you mitigate Genestealer Cult is by letting them go first. But then you've let them go first, so you've given them a huge advantage. And that also seemed fitting with the Genestealer Cults, because they don't tend to fare too well when faced with the business end of a bolt gun. So they kind of like start with this kind of like, you know, they've launched their attack and they kind of are on you, they've got the momentum, and it's all about whether or not the Genestealer Cult player can maintain that momentum and keep the enemy on the back foot. And if they can, then they've got a good chance of grabbing those objectives or doing what they can. If the opponent can kind of keep cool, fire focus, and kind of like, you know, counterattack essentially, then it can start to swing the other way. So instantly we had like this really cool play style, which has come out of a unique bespoke mechanic.
Mm-hmm. And is that something that you'd plan to look at for other codexes or armies in the future? To
I think it's pushed us. It's definitely the kind of like the benchmark going forward is kind of going, all right, how can we get our army special rules kind of working a little bit harder for us? Mm-hmm. And I think looking back now, it's probably the area of 40K where we started off from 7th edition to 8th edition, and we kind of thought, army special rules, we kind of know what those are. And we were very much focused on detachment abilities and things like that. But I think now we've kind of come to like the cycle of codexes, we can kind of look back and go, actually, this kind of like area of rules writing has been left fallow for a while. We can look to explore that and kind of make that work hard for us as well.
It feels as well that you've been putting attention into making sure each unit has a role. And I think we talked about this in the Stormcast. Historically, you'd find your entry-level troops unit was the least exciting unit in the game. Mm. And then everything else was more exciting in some fashion that showed you the comparison. But all Space Marines are exciting, really. All Neophyte Hybrids are exciting. Neophyte Hybrids and a Genestealer Cult army have a purpose. So it feels like there's attention to make sure every unit has its particular role to play and the abilities that would go with that.
Yeah, I think that's very much our focus now, is going back and not only making sure that every unit has its role, and I think your example is right. We want to make sure that your Space Marine Intercessors are the thing that you really want to take, not that you feel like you have to take in order to get and play with the cool toys. But actually, there are different combinations of units that you can take, and that's kind of the play style idea. So with Genestealer Cults, if you want to go down a infantry ambushing kind of like heavy army, then you can absolutely do that. Mm-hmm. If you want to kind of have more the biker heavy kind of fast outflanking army, that's fine. If you want to go down the more kind of Genestealer patriarch and
monsters,
aberrants, and yeah, just kind of like horribleness, then you've got those different units open to you, and all the different characters kind of support different elements and kind of plug in and out of that. So you've not only got kind of like the army with this army special rule, you've got like different units within that army, and that's before you then even layer in kind of the different kind of faction abilities and relics and stratagems that all kind of come in there. And I think part of the skill, particularly at the top end, is kind of like finding all those different kind of combinations and synergies and kind of getting them to work and do the things you want. That's also part of the joy, is kind of like going down and finding those things.
And one of the features as well that we've seen over the last year adding to codexes or being added to codexes is a piece of specific scenery, race specific scenery, the designers call it. And the Genestealer Cults came with a tectonic frag drill, which must then be another feature, another lever to consider when you're considering all of the synergies or permutations or additions. But you've had a year of practicing and getting the best ideas out of how to present those. Was the tectonic frag drill the culmination of what had been going into codexes the previous year?
I think when the tectonic frag drill came along, we really had an idea of the army special rule. So it was something that we knew could tie in directly with that. Before that, we've had the waygate for the Eldar. Mm-hmm. So that kind of tied into a kind of core bit of their background, and we had the kind of the Nurgle Woods as well.
The feculent Narmal.
But yeah, these things are becoming more and more common. I think they're just more interesting when you can tie them in with your army, make them part of your army, but actually have some strategies that are going to work with your army. So if you're going to rely heavily on ambushing, tectonic frag drills are kind of a great ad for kind of popping in and out, and as well as kind of like having a kind of a cool effect in and of itself.
Very nice. And we've seen recently Age of Sigmar 2 coming out, and we've seen Kill Team, the new edition of Kill Team, came out not too long ago. Have you seen any rules mechanics in there that you've thought that could have a home in Warhammer 40,000 one day? Is there anything?
Yeah, very much so. David Sanders was kind of like the mastermind behind Kill Team. Mm-hmm. He did an awful lot of work with that, and I was very privileged to kind of like work alongside him and give him some feedback and pointers. I got to write Rogue Trader, so it's kind of like those kind of like close confine rules and things like that. And it was great to kind of play much smaller individual things. But yeah, there are certain rules there that you just go, oh, actually, that's really neat. And I think as a games developer, you're always looking for kind of those kind of cool ideas, and you kind of like squirrel them away and, oh, actually, that's quite good. I always have a I don't have breakfast with Jervis most mornings, and we kind of like often talking about mechanics and all the rest of it. And sometimes you like say, "Oh, I see. So you've just taken that rule, and you swap back and forth." And I think that's what you're always doing. It's not just feedback. It's just, I've got a cool idea for this, that, and the other. And a lot of rules writing is problem solving. Essentially, you've got this idea that you want to kind of like get down. How do you get there? And sometimes you kind of like running on. I can't find the right lock to this key. Nothing's quite working. And then you'll be having a random conversation over breakfast a week or two later. Like, oh, that might be a brilliant idea to kind of unlock that or get this particular mechanic working. Oh, yeah, why don't we use a D66 table or whatever it might be? And then suddenly it all kind of falls into place.
I love a good D66 table.
Who doesn't?
So knowing that what books and box games put together, the things that you'll write rules for will be driven by what new miniatures get produced or what miniatures come along and the desire to make books and box games based on those. So I can't ask you what miniatures will get made, but what aspect of the past, what things from previous editions or what miniatures from the past would you love to see as a hobbyist, would you love to see presented by miniatures at some point in the future so that you could write rules for them? Because there's been an awful lot of nostalgia dredged up by, I guess, Necromunda recently and releases like the Genestealer Cults. Is there anything else that hasn't yet manifested that you'd love to work on?
Oh, goodness. You've completely stumped me there. I love working on all the different bits and bobs of it. Codex Howling Griffins is only going to be so long before I finally get my my hands on that. No, not really. I think what you're seeing in specialist games with kind of like Adeptus Titanicus, I think kind of like hits a lot of the things that got me into the hobby to begin with. What we're seeing with Kill Team now is kind of like doing a lot of those kind of like smaller skirmish kind of like games that are lots of fun. Shade Spires allow me to do lots of the board game things, which is the kind of like bit I like to do for my own kind of hobby. So no, I anything and everything, I'm just happy to work here.
Oh, I understand. You're professional enough that that'll be the diplomatic answer for everything. Just trying to get into your head a little bit just to see what bits of the hobby you like or if there's any older miniatures that you'd love to see remade. Mine's Arbitrators, for what it's worth. That was like...
Oh, the Arbitrator Lights.
Yeah. As another human face in the Imperium, I think it's a great thing to see in Warhammer 40,000, something I'm very excited about for the Adeptus Sororitas, that it's not just Primarchs and demigod-like space marines fighting out in the Imperium. When you see that conflict between the Imperium and Chaos, or whoever it may be, at every level, at every strata, down to the kind of cops and robbers level as well. I'm looking out for something like that at some point in the future. That'll make me happy.
I think I would have answered rogue traders and things like that, but we've done that. So the guys downstairs are kind of like keeping a pace with anything I could think of. That's why they make the miniatures.
Okay. Well, then rules wise, are there any sorts of expansions or rules mechanics that you'd like to write for Warhammer 40,000? Is there anything that you've not quite, or anything that was formatively looked at in some of those little expansions at the back of the core rulebook? And we've seen that Cities of Death has been explored out into the Urban Conquest box.
Yeah,
are there any other expansions or bits you'd like to work on?
Yeah, so Urban Conquest was great to kind of like realise that. I'm very interested in kind of campaigns and what more we could do, particularly kind of like narrative campaigns. I'm also very interested to kind of look at kind of like more of the kind of the organised event and kind of like see what we... As a studio could kind of like put forward and kind of like different formats for tournaments or events or anything like that.
Are you going to be going to any events in 2019? Got anything on the calendar?
Oh, I hope so. It's loads of fun going to events. You always get to talk to again different people doing different things about the hobby, whether they're there from a gaming point of view or from a background point of view. It doesn't matter. They've always got some kind of cool insights. So I was lucky to go to Nova last year. I'd love to go back. There's Adepticon. I'll go to any event that I'm invited to if I can get to it. They're just loads of fun. I always go around with a little black book, which is my little notepad. If I notice any kind of like rules quirk or something like that, or something's not quite working, I'll make a note of it. But I also use it as a opportunity when I'm talking to people just to kind of like find out what do you guys like about the rules? What's your favorite rule? I tend to ask two questions. If you could change anything, one rule, you had like a magic wand, you could change one rule, what would it be and why? And then if there's one rule or one mechanic that I'm not allowed to change, What are you going to safeguard? What won't that be? And that's very interesting. When we come around to doing our kind of like our online updates, or we're thinking about this expansion or that expansion, that's the sort of thing that we go back to and kind of go, okay, what are people enjoying? So, you know, stratagems, you know, been wildly popular. Yeah. Cool. They're probably not going anywhere as a result.
Have you had any trends in the answers? It sounds like people like command points and stratagems. Are there any trends, other things that shouldn't change?
Yeah, so I think there's a, you know, some of it's kind of very subtle, you know, having the charge phase and the fight phase as two distinct phases. Mm-hmm. We just thought it would be something that would kind of clear things up from a mechanics point of view, but people really seem to appreciate that. So yeah, we're not going to fold those back up into a single phase anytime soon. Command point generation, a number of command points that you get, you know, you can see from some of our beta rules, you know, they have been born out of a lot of those conversations. The tactical restraint match play rule that we had out literally came out of a it wasn't the number of command points that people seem to be kind of aggrieved. You know, if you want to spend all your command points to do this kind of super duper combo, you know, one hit wonder, brilliant, that was great. It was being able to do that every single turn, because you do this thing and then you regenerate half them back, and then you do something else and get another half back, and then suddenly you're kind of like your pool of command points, your precious resource, is enabling you to do like things left, right, and center. So, you know, we try out beta rules to kind of like address those things and make sure that the game is keeping a pace with how people are playing it at the moment. Mm-hmm. And it's giving people the most fun, the most rewarding experience that they can do. But it is beta because we want people's feedback on that, and we invite that back. And if it's not quite right, then we'll change that. We did that with Psychic Focus. We were getting an awful lot of I won't say complaints, but feedback about smite spam. Oh, there's too much smite around, too many mortal wounds. I'm like, okay, well, what we can do to try and do that is kind of increase the warp charge value, or we got some feedback saying, actually, it's really hurting Grey Knights and Thousand Suns. You're like, well, you know, we didn't mean it. They are kind of like, you know, a whole army of space wizards. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't be kind of like penalizing them too much. So, you know, when we made that the final version, we made sure to kind of exempt them and stuff like that. So, you know, we do adapt and change these things based on feedback.
Okay. And apart from feedback on beta rules or the beta Sisters of Battle rules, what are you most looking forward to seeing from the community in 2019?
I think now that all the codexes are out there, I think it's a level playing field, and you've got chapter approved now to kind of like readjust a lot of those kind of points values in light of all those codexes being out there. I'm looking forward to being surprised by whatever comes next. I think part of the joy of the games developer is being able to see what are the combinations people are using. Every time you change something, you've changed the system a little bit. Every match play rule will change the meta a little bit. And it's kind of like seeing what cool combinations people kind of come up with.
I know we've talked a little bit on Warhammer Live about Chapter Approved 2018. What are you most excited, what were you most pleased by working on in that book that will be part of the firmament of 40K for the next year?
The Beta Codex Sisters of Battle was lots of fun. I've got there's a soft spot in my heart for Sisters of Battle, having worked on them for so many years. I'd love to see the eight. I'd love to see the eight at the GT tables or something like that. So yeah, have to wait and see.
That is a bit of a gauntlet to lay down for somebody, but I imagine someone might take you up on it. Are you not going to try it yourself?
Me, the eight. I'm howling Griffins to the core when it comes to GTs.
Would you be likely to attend any of the GT heats in any capacity? Are you going as a player or in your own capacity as Robin Cruddace?
So I'm hoping to attend the final just to kind of like pop along, talk to some people, take some notes, kind of things. Yeah, we'll see. I might rise to the challenge and get my Space Marines into action.
Have you got an army list in mind, or could you put together?
I could put one together. I've got 6,000 points of them. Yeah, okay, yeah. I could put one together.
And you know the people to ask to help break the game or identify the things.
Yeah. One of the things as a games developer is we're notoriously bad at our own games. The kind of excuse I always use is that we're always thinking about the underlying mechanics, and is that working as an attending, and that distracts us from, you know, things like tactics and strategy. That's the excuse I'll kind of like settle with. But yeah, I'll probably also go, if I can, try and attend an Age of Sigmar event. So whilst I kind of look after 140,000, I do every now and again kind of like I go play some Age of Sigmar, and it's it's a great game, and you can learn lots from it as a games developer. So you always got to see what's going on out there.
I talked to Jay Clare recently about the Middle Earth strategy battle game Grand Tournament. He's the rules writer for that system, and he said he was going to go to the tournament, and his approach was to write one army list for every army in the game, and then step back and decide which was the best list, which is chilling to someone like me who plays with the one army that I like, which is World Eaters, and they're not very good, but I'm fine with that. Could you ever see yourself doing that? Would you be able to step away from your Howling Griffins for an event, something like a tournament, and really just look at the numbers, or would you just have to go with your Howling Griffins and try to make the best out of your 6,000 point collection?
Yeah, possibly. I think I could definitely go to one of my other armies, and I could definitely see myself writing a list for my Necrons or for my Grey Knights or something like that. I think I just like my red and yellow Marines, and it's just quite. It's not just about the winning. I quite like the painting aspect of it too, and kind of the. The first events I ever attended to were kind of like narrative campaign weekends, and actually the first sort of 10-15 minutes people are just kind of talking about their armies. Oh, how'd you paint that? Oh yes, I like the kind of like the campaign markings that you've put on, stuff like that. So that's kind of ingrained into me. But yeah, why not? I'd like to think I'm good enough to kind of qualify, but we will see.
In your own game system.
Yeah. Nothing like getting beat at your own game.
If not, I can see an errata coming out a few weeks after that, just to redress the balance.
Anything to help me, yeah. Games developer re-roll, it's a thing.
Yeah, you get that made on a t-shirt. Take it along to the event, that'll be fine. I'm sure people would give you the benefit of the doubt. Well, all of the Codex is out now, as you've just let us know that's all the Codexes. That's all the Codexes that we knew in the 7th edition firmament before this, so that must be all that there is to come. I guess we'll let you go back and work on whatever other Warhammer 40,000 related pursuits you might find time in your day to work on. Thank you very much for giving us this time, Robin. That's a great insight into making Warhammer 40,000, making this great 8th edition, and the Codex Genestealer Cults, and I hope we can get you onto the show again in the future.
It'd be a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Cheers.